Okay, maybe you can start the second part of this morning. So we have three different talks. Well, two talks. Two presentations and one Blackboard presentation too. So the first one is by Pier-Marco Canarsa from University of Rome, Tor Vergata. So you have the floor. So after 20 minutes, I will give you a 5-minute signal, okay?
Okay, thank you.
5 minutes for questions.
Okay, thank you. Let's see if I need a microphone or if you can hear me. Okay. So first of all, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity of getting acquainted with the community. I don't see very often, in fact. For me, application to climate is an interest that stems from essentially control of PDE and inverse problems techniques. And in fact, in this talk, I will mainly speak about some results concerning parameter determination, which are obtained by, well, inverse problems techniques developed for PDEs, for parabolic PDEs, in particular for degenerate parabolic PDEs. So the model, it's a simple model. I will briefly recall it at the beginning just to set the language, the notation. And then I will concentrate on the Sandler's model, adding a memory term, a short survey of well-posedness techniques to end up with the reconstruction results, and in particular with Lipschitz stability results. So as you know very well, in energy balance models, there is a hierarchy depending on, essentially for me, the space dimension, from dimension zero up to dimension three. In this talk, I will focus on the 1D case. I will focus on the 1D case, which corresponds to taking average at points of fixed latitude. Of course, this is an approximation that is widely used because it simplifies the model, but it does introduce some difficulty, which is usually neglected, which is degeneracy. So the equation is, is the well-known one where the variation of temperature is given as a balance of absorbed energy, emitted energy, and diffusion. And as far as diffusion, we will see, we will take a very easy model, a linear model. For the absorbed energy, as usual, we assume dependence on the albedo, and this is the co-albedo. And we will be interested in reconstructing these coefficients here, the insulation function in particular. And for the emitted energy, we will mainly focus on Sandler's model, but with some non-trivial addition. Okay. In particular, when modeling the absorbed energy, we will not neglect the effect of memory. This point was made in a paper by Michael Gill and collaborators back in the 80s, and then developed further in following papers. And this take, I mean, the memory term, the memory effect takes into account, for example, the long response of ice sheets temperature changes, and it affects the equation, enriching the dynamics. okay. As for the diffusion, well, diffusion has been studied in several different models. I mean, taking several different models. We will consider the linear model, where taking for space variable the sign of the polaritude, you end up with a second order operator, which is degenerate at the endpoints. Of course, this degeneracy is induced, is artificial. If you look at the 2D model on a sphere, you don't have degeneracy. You have a heat equation on a sphere. On the other hand, if you pretend to reduce the problem by taking averages, well, there is a price to pay, especially. And the price to pay is exactly this fact, that you lose positive definiteness at the endpoints. And this degeneracy causes, of course, some trouble, which is not always considered. Most of the more classical results just take pure second derivative, neglecting the degeneracy. But it does have an effect. It doesn't have an effect, as we will see, on the boundary condition you can allow for this problem, and it doesn't have an effect on the tools, on the mathematical tools you have to use, for example, Carnot estimates. Well, having said that, people have studied also nonlinear models of diffusion with different perspectives. But yes?
The degeneracy is not too bad because it's a so-called limit point case of the Tichmasz-Podaia theory.
Yeah, it's not too bad. It's not too good either. For example, you could not impose Dirichlet boundary condition with this kind of degeneracy.
Fortunately, that's
the boundary condition one is interested here. Here, I mean, with this kind of degeneracy, essentially, the boundary condition is encoded in the operator. And it is of Neumann type.
Yeah, but that was already handled in my thing.
Oh, yes, sure. No, this is... okay. Okay, so to summarize, I'm here. So we will be interested in the 1D degenerate model. There will be nonlinear source terms. In the Budico case, you also have this continuity. I will not concentrate on the Budico case for the emitted energy in this talk. And there are also nonlinear non-local terms representing the memory effect. These are the the main difficulties. Oh, nevertheless, there has been a lot of work. Of course, the problem is pretty classical, and multiple steady states have been widely investigated, and their stability, existence of solutions, uniqueness, non-uniqueness, especially with the Budico model for the long time behavior of solution has also been investigated, and some results on inverse problems are in fact I will comment on them more in more details by Michael Gill and his collaborators. So just to fix the notation, let us have a look at the Sellers kind model with memory. As we were saying before, I mean, it is not such a bad degeneracy, but yet with this kind of degeneracy, you can only essentially impose this kind of boundary condition, and rho zero can be just here. does do any difference, doesn't make any difference, because the normal kind of degeneracy is encoded in the realization of this operation, in an L2 topology. We will basically work with the L2 in space topology. So we assume, as I anticipated, the dependence on the past history, which is modeled by a nonlinear function of this integral, where k is some kernel, we will make further assumptions on the kernel k in order to obtain the results we are
looking for. Yes. I'm talking again, but the 2014 paper really is Rock, Shekroon, and some other people.
Yeah.
It's not Gillibout.
I know there is a
Michael is in the room.
So we come later. I will.
Well, you see, 40 years of your career on several of these slides.
Well, no, it's not. The point is, I don't need the extra credit.
Shows how long you've been working. I've seen you've done a lot of things in between.
But it connects well to the 1982, anyways. It's sort of intersection. Okay. So here the goal will be to reconstruct the insulation function, the insulation function, the one I called Q here. One could be interested in reconstructing other parameters. But okay, so far we will see how to operate to recover Q. And again, I stress that the difficulties are related to degeneracy, nonlinearity, and the presence of a non-local term. I will essentially describe two kinds of results. One is about uniqueness with a pointwise kind of measurement, and the other is the Lipschitz stability. So let me explain better. So in order to solve the equation, you have to set the problem in some state spaces, which are essentially modeled, tailored on the L2 topology in the interval -1, 1, which I label by I. Rho is our degenerate coefficient, and I'm taking as energy states, essentially absolutely continuous functions locally in the interval, so not on the boundary, for which this function here, so the square root of your weight of your degenerate coefficient times the derivative is in L2. And then you can introduce a second order operator by just in a natural way by taking as its domain the function in the energy space for which this term is differentiable with an L2 derivative is in the space that is called H1. So the domain of A is essentially a space of functions which are weakly differentiable in of order 2 with an L2 derivative with respect to some weight. And the weight is related to the degeneracy, and therefore the behavior at the boundary of these functions is not so nice as you would expect if there was no degeneracy. This operator is self-adjoint and generates a semigroup, and the semigroup allows you to construct solution of the abstract version of the problem in which the memory effect is modeled by a non-local term acting on translations. So this is not translation, this UT, and then solutions have to be Solutions have to be intended in the sense of mild solutions at the beginning, solutions of some fixed point of this kind of operator, which are then regularized if data are more regular. Basically, the space in which you obtain solution, so you have to give an initial condition, and the initial condition, due to the presence of the memory term, has to be defined not only at zero, but also on a left in neighborhood of zero, which I denote by minus tau zero. So your solution is going to be continuous from minus tau to some finite horizon capital T with values in the energy space, and moreover with some extra regularity on the space derivative and on the time derivative. So the time derivative is square summable, and the space derivative of order two is summable with respect to the weights I introduced before. And so once you have that, you can show, I mean, this is a classical result. You can prove it also in dimension two on the sphere. And or with the degeneracy, you with memory, I mean, several people worked on this result, and essentially the technique is the usual one. You first prove local existence and uniqueness, then you prove some bound, and from these bounds you get global existence. So let's now move to the reconstruction part. So the problem is, suppose you are given two coefficients, Q and Q tilde, and so you solve two solutions, in fact, of the same kind of Sellers model with memory, with different initial conditions and different insulation functions. And you would like to know under what kind of measurements of the solution you can say something on this data, in particular on Q. And essentially, I will describe two kinds of results. One is what is called uniqueness or unique continuation. Suppose a measurement tells you that the two solutions coincide on a small set. Can you say that the coefficients are the same? And then Lipschitz stability, which is a sort of quantified version of the previous information. Suppose you can measure the difference between solution on some set as small as possible. Of course, it will be larger than in the first case. Then can you say that the difference in coefficient will be small accordingly? Okay, so the interest in this kind of determination result is, of course, the fact that in general, these parameters that appear even in the simple model perturbed with memory, the coefficient, the parameters are not easy to evaluate a priori. So all the ways we have to sort of give an estimation that is that fits the data is welcome. And so one way is to go through this uniqueness. Uniqueness is the first step. I mean, if you don't have uniqueness, you don't go for Lipschitz stability. But once you have uniqueness of the reconstruction, then you can move to a quantified version, which is really more fit for a numerical approximation. The meaning of the Lipschitz stability is that then you can consider approximations of the parameters by penalization, and they are stable thanks to these estimates. So for the uniqueness part, let me describe a result. Let's restrict the class of admissible initial condition to smooth functions on the past, and the class of admissible coefficients to reconstruct to piecewise analytic Lipschitz continuous functions, and assume also on the memory kernels a condition that says that in some neighborhood of zero, of t equals zero, the kernel vanishes. So that the latest times, the one closest to zero, do not affect the behavior of the kernel, basically. And so this is the result I was referring to before. This is the 2014 result by Rox, Chukrun, Christoffel, Soberand, and Gill. So under these assumptions of the coefficient, this was analyticity and so on, and suppose the initial conditions are the same, so the data coincide well in the past history, and then you have a point x zero on which you measure the same thing on the two solution for some interval of time, same values and same flux and same derivative. Then you can conclude that the parameters, the two coefficients coincide.
So here this mark, this what you referred previously as a small set is really just one point.
Yes, but you also
here have the derivative.
You have to have the derivative, exactly. And you have to know that the past history is the same in this system.
Right.
And so this is the uniqueness part. And to move to the Lipschitz stability part, so you have the same situation as before. But now you want to prove an estimate, a uniform estimate for all possible choices of initial conditions and coefficients. So here I change a bit the class of admissible initial condition and admissible coefficients, keeping the same support condition on the memory kernel. For the coefficients, well, I relax analyticity to being essentially bounded in a uniform way. So I'm given two constants, m and m1, m prime in this case. And so I just take a ball in L infinity of radius m prime for the coefficients. And for the initial condition, well, I have to take a stronger norm. So I have to take initial conditions which are in the domain of A, so twice differentiable in a weighted sense with the bounded derivative. And also I'm going to impose a uniform bound on these initial conditions given by M. Since I want to get a uniform constant, I have to select the class of problems with uniform initial condition, bounded uniformly, uniformly bounded coefficients. So, and the result is the following, saying, well, in this case, you are given, you fix M and M prime and you select initial conditions in the and the coefficients in the corresponding classes. You also suppose, essentially to know the the difference of the past histories. So what you know is on the right hand side. Your measurements of the solution imply an estimate on the coefficient. So this is the Lipschitz estimate on the coefficient. It depends on what you measure as difference of the past history, and then also on measurements of the solution of two kinds. One on the whole domain at a fixed time t prime, and the other on the interval 0t on a smaller on any smaller domain AB. So if you can measure solution on these two sets, a smaller domain times the full time interval and the whole domain at a fixed d prime, then you get a Lipschitz estimate on the coefficients in L2 norm. And well, this result was first proved by Tort and Van Kostenhove in a 2012 paper without the presence of the memory effect. And just to give a brief account of the techniques one uses. Okay. Well, the technique is an adaptation, non-trivial adaptation of the technique developed by Yamamoto and Imanovilov for parabolic problems. So essentially, you take the difference of the solutions and you write the problems which is solved by this difference. And you get a bunch of terms as forcing terms. And what you are really interested in is the first one, because it is from this term that you will recover an estimate on the difference of the coefficients. So what you have to do is essentially to bound as well as possible all the other terms, and you get an estimate on this by difference. So this term has some nice property with respect to time, and this is one information we need. But then you also need essentially what is called Kahneman estimate. So an a priori estimate on the time derivative of the solution, which is a weighted estimate on the time derivative of the solution in terms of a certain number of terms, in which I have, here are your terms you like. This term is going to be neglected because, and therefore eventually you put everything together and you estimate your term here, which provides an estimate on the coefficients by things that you can bound either directly or through the use of a Kahneman estimate in this way. So the adaptation of Kahneman estimate to the generate parabolic problems is non-trivial because, you have to select the weight functions appropriately, but this enters the technical bar. So to conclude, let me just describe ongoing research of a similar flavor. Here we are studying a model with two layers, one at a sort of oceanic level and one at an upper atmospheric level. So there are interactions. It's again a 2D model. So you find the degeneracy in both equations. And of course, here there are some basic issues that are interesting even in well-posedness and then in the analysis of equilibrium solution, which is an interesting point already in the zero D IAR level, and of course, eventually inverse problems. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very questions?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. So I think later on we're going to be hearing a talk by Vincent Martinez, which I realize is not the same Martinez as this Martinez,
no.
But about how to dynamically reconstruct parameters or forcings in the Navier-Stokes equation. So in a way, what you are doing is, I don't want to say a simpler version, but so this method doesn't give, what you are doing here doesn't give you a way to actually reconstruct the parameter, right? It's not.
Well, which parameter?
The function R.
Oh, the function, here we are interested in the function Q.
Q, yeah.
Okay, here. It provides you this estimate. So you get this kind of estimates, and then you can use sort of variational approach to reconstructing the, you minimize functionals with a penalization. And this estimate allow you to, well, to go to zero with the or plus infinity with the penalizing coefficient. And so this is what is needed in order for classical reconstruction procedure to converge.
Right.
Yes, I can make a remark on that, Jochen.
Yes.
In the 2014 paper that was like recited actually a couple of times. So we do solve this problem.
Okay.
So we like the uniqueness problem, like we have shown exactly that you, the, you find the estimate. But first of all, the inverse problem is well posed by when you know u and the derivative of u at one point with the history.
Yeah.
But then we also like illustrated numerically that using a like a maximum likelihood. When we have and we include like noise into the measurement that can like, you know, as it is the case, right, Michael, in the
yeah
in the ice core, like the noise can go like following a Poisson process, then we can have like estimates using this maximum likelihood. So it's related to solving the Nagmin problem. So that it's actually dealt with in this
okay.
paper. So I recommend you also to read this paper. And check one is with the C-H-E-K.
After all these corrections, just, I just want, I was hoping that Mikhail would clarify some of the technical points, but what I would like to say is that for the present climate, of course, we know the insulation better than we know the temperature. The point of this paper was to look at proxy records of temperature in paleoclimate. Mm-hmm. And to reconstruct insulation mm-hmm. in the past, which is not as well known as temperature.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, there's beautiful math, but there's also some physical sense
mm-hmm.
what is being done.
You're right about the name, but I have done these French collaborators and they are specialized in mispending names. One example is Riccati. That is always coming with the wrong C's. And so you are in good company.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, so thank you very much for this very nice talk.